Learn about plant propagation next on Gardener's Hotline. This is Gardener's Hotline, and I'm your host, Karen Stotterman, a University of Florida Horticulture Extension agent. Plant propagation is a process in creating new plants from a variety of sources. Seeds, cuttings, and bulbs are just a few ways to multiply plants. It can be a very economical way to add more plants to your landscape with little to no extra cost. Want to learn more? Well, you're in luck. Today's guest will show us methods of propagating unique plants and provide tips for success in this process. Join me in welcoming back Tom Wickman. He's a Florida Master Gardener Coordinator. Welcome back, Tom.
Karen, thanks for having me. I'm so excited to be here.
Oh, Tom, it's always a pleasure to have you back on the show again to give us some extra tips on how we can propagate some plants. Tell me, how long have you been with the university?
I've been with the university almost 20 years now.
And what do you do for them?
Well, I'm the state Master Gardener Coordinator, so that I run the statewide volunteer program that works through the local cooperative extension service in each county, and we have active programs in 60 of the 67 counties. We've got almost 5,000 volunteers, and they're amazing folks. They give almost $7,000 worth of volunteer time just last year alone.
That's amazing. Boy, you have a big job there.
Yeah, we couldn't operate and teach all the homeowners about horticulture in the state of Florida without our volunteers.
Yes, that's so valuable. Well, tell me, where are you located, on campus?
We're located on campus. That's at University of Florida in Gainesville, and we're very proud of our facilities. We've got a first-rate greenhouse complex there where the researchers do a lot of research on trying to answer the questions of tomorrow, how best to produce plants, what may be the best varieties, doing plant breeding and all kinds of different work. It's amazing.
That's great for all kids of all ages to get into as well. This is the ornamental horticulture?
This is environmental horticulture.
Environmental.
Years ago, it used to be ornamental horticulture. We call it environmental horticulture today.
All right.
And, you know, certainly the university wouldn't be anything without the energy the students bring. And, of course, we have our extension demonstration projects as well.
Well, tell me a little bit about what goes on there when you start to collect plants for propagating.
Well, you know, when we start looking at, we've got a wonderful conservatory, so we can collect cuttings and things and have all different plant material there. Of course, there's plantings all around campus as well. So there's outdoor plants, there's indoor plants, we've got perennials, we've got annuals, we've got all different things. So there's a lot of different material that we can collect. And today we're going to talk about how to propagate and how to multiply a lot of the plants that a homeowner may have so that they don't have to go out and spend so much, you know, buying new things. You know, and maybe they can even get some cutting material from a neighbor, perhaps, that might have a wonderful plant they've always wanted.
Right, right. But that sounds like you have an awful lot on your plate, and it sounds like you have some great plants out there. Are the conservatory open to the public, or is that mostly for the research area?
It is in the research area, so it's not something that's open to the public at this point in time. But, you know, it really is a resource for us. There's occasional opportunities where some of the greenhouse complex is open for some public events. You know, sometimes during the holidays there's a poinsettia event, and there may be other events that the public may be invited in from time to time.
Well, speaking of inviting the public, let's invite our viewers at home to join in with this program by calling this number. It's 1-800-901-9238. Well, I know before long you're going to start getting some phone calls, so let's dive into it and let's get started on the basics of plant propagation.
Okay. One of the easiest ways to get started in propagating plants is by doing cuttings. Now, cuttings are creating exact duplicates of their parent plants. This is asexual propagation, and we create clones of the parent plant. So if we take a cutting of this penta, for instance, one of my favorite perennials, by the way. Pentas are kind of wonderful here. This beautiful pink penta is a perennial that's tough. It may freeze in the wintertime, but it comes right back, blooms all throughout the warm months of the year, comes in reds, whites,
wow,
pinks. It'll attract hummingbirds as well as butterflies. So, you know, a lot of reasons to multiply and have pentas. And so, you know, It's as easy as just picking out a few areas where you might be able to prune.
Now, when it flowers, does it make it worse to do cuttings? Should we do it when it's flowering, non-flowering, or does it matter?
Ideally, it's best if it's not flowering. If it is flowering, I'd recommend removing the flower buds. Now, a lot of people are confused. They think cuttings need to be, you know, really long, like 10 or 12 inches long, because we'll get a bigger plant faster. But that's not going to root very well. So we normally want our cutting to be somewhere in the probably 3 to 5 inch length.
What time of year can a person do those cuttings?
Oh, probably any time during the warmer months of the year is probably the best time. That's when things are going to root the best. And, you know, you could do it during the cooler months of the year, but you might have to supply some artificial heat. So here we've got some small cuttings. These are in the 3 to 4 inch range right now. And I mentioned the flower buds. We'll pinch any of the flower buds off just so that they don't take any energy away from the plant. We have a small stem at the base, and so that's going to go into our media, whatever we're planting in. If we have any leaves that would be at the base, we're going to go ahead and take off those lower leaves so that we don't have any leaves into the whatever media we're planting in. And you keep hearing me say media. We could plant in soil. We can plant in, I like vermiculite. And, here I've got pots of soil. This is just good, general, clean potting media that you can get in the local garden center.
Mostly peat, right?
It's peat with a little bit of perlite and a little bit of bark in it as well. Nice and well-drained, and it is clean and sterile. We always want to start with nice, sterile media.
But do you wet your soil first before you do the propagation? Okay.
It would be best. This is a little on the dry side, but ideally, if I was propagating, we'd want to put it into wet media.
Okay.
But my favorite media to use is vermiculite. This is an expanded mica clay, and it's sterile. And what we really need it to do is just to hold up our cuttings and to hold some moisture and have some air and oxygen provided. So, you know, it works out really well. So all we have to do, I like to use rooting hormone, too, because rooting hormone will speed the process along.
Well, tell us a little bit about what rooting hormone is and where we can get it.
Rooting hormones are a mixture of auxins. Auxins are the hormone that we use to create roots on cuttings. And so they'll come in liquids, they'll come in powders. You can find them at your local garden centers. They're available at your big box stores as well. But follow the label instructions. They'll tell you how to use them.
Does it stink?
Typically very little smell to them. But what you're going to typically do when you follow the label, this one happens to be a powder. You dip it into the powder, you tap off any excess, and then all you have to do is stick it right into the media that you have.
You don't wet your stem ahead of time and dip it in. You do it directly dry.
These don't need to be wet. They were just taken and they were fresh. Ideally, we want to have nice wet, nice fresh cuttings. And that way we can go ahead and all we do is stick those right in our media again. And very quickly, we can create lots of cuttings, and these will root very quickly.
How long do you think it'll take before they root?
Oh, those will probably root within, probably 4 or 5 weeks.
Okay.
We'll start seeing roots on these. You can always test whether something's rooted by giving it a gentle little tug. Don't pull hard on it, but give it a little tug. If it starts pulling back, you know that there's roots there. Don't rush the process, and then you can always pick the pot up, check the base, see if there's any roots coming out of the bottom so you know that there's plenty of roots. Once you see plenty of roots there, you can always think about transplanting it into a larger pot or eventually putting it into the ground.
Now, do you want to maintain humidity here? Do you want to put a little Ziploc bag or in the shade? What would you recommend?
You're the expert. Great. That's a wonderful question because, you know, humidity is the key to getting things going. Commercially on campus, we have the way the commercial guys do things is they have mist beds, entire mist houses that leave a layer of moisture on the leaves all day long. So that mist may run for maybe 5 seconds every 7 or 8 minutes just to keep a film of moisture on the surface. So this never is lacking for water. Well, the homeowner doesn't have that typically. And so how do we keep moisture up? Well, some people will have like an aquarium that they could perhaps set this in that might have a lid, keep it in a nice shady area, keep the moisture up. An easy trick for those people that don't have that might be to take a nice clear plastic bag, set our pot of cutting, right into that clear plastic bag, and we're going to close it up most of the way. You're going to need to make sure you keep this out of direct sunlight. Otherwise, you're going to end up cooking your new cutting, and you don't want to do that. You don't want to burn it up. But you'll open this up every couple of days to allow a little bit of fresh air, a little bit of gas exchange in there, and that will definitely speed up the process. If you don't have a big enough bag, you don't have something like this, put it in a nice shady, cool area of your landscape. Keep it moist, but try not to keep it too wet.
I see. Well, we've got a caller from Orlando that'd like to join the program. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question today?
Good evening. My name is Madeline. I'm from Orlando. I'd like to know how difficult it is to root cutting from camellias.
Okay. Madeline, camellias can be a little difficult, a little on the slow side. How I like to propagate my camellias is rather than taking cuttings, because you kind of really have to be an expert to be able to do well and succeed there, but they're very easy to air layer. And we may have a chance later in the show to air layer something, but if not, you can look that up or come into the extension office. They'll show you how you can propagate via air layering. And what that does is it creates a cutting on the mother plant, and so it allows it to root while it's still connected to the mother plant, so it's never wanting for anything. And then once it's rooted, then we take it off and separate it. That's the easiest way. The time to do that usually is in the spring months. Anywhere from about March through May is probably the best time to air layer our plants, our camellia plants, and it will take probably about 4 months before we start harvesting those air layers.
When you air layer it, do you add any extra fertilizer to jump start, you know, the formation of roots? Do you add anything in particular?
Well, ideally, what we're going to do is create a wound in the bark. So we're going to strip off the outer layer of bark. We're going to use a rooting hormone. It could be that powder. It could be the liquid that we showed. I like to use the powder, dust that wound. We're going to wrap it in nice, moist sphagnum moss, and then we cover that with plastic to hold that moisture in. And then we cover that plastic with something that's going to keep the sunlight out. So we'll wrap it in tin foil or something that's going to reflect the sunlight so, again, we don't burn those roots. And then we check it from time to time just to make sure that moss stays nice and moist. And after about 4 months, you'll see the roots that are formed in that moss. Once it's rooted, we cut it right below that, and we've got a large rooted cutting right there.
And that's 4 months, whereas a cutting would be 4 weeks.
Exactly. Now, but a cutting of a camellia would be much slower than that. And so, you know, they're tough. And so the homeowner's, average homeowner's not going to succeed real well with those cuttings.
Okay.
They'll be better air layering.
Okay. Well, why don't you talk a little bit about another plant specimen we have here? And while you're doing that, I'm going to remind all the viewers at home the number again, just in case I was too quick on that. It's 1-800-901-9238. And while you're cutting those, tell me a little bit about the difference in when you would use vermiculite and when you would use your peat type of soils.
Okay, I almost always use the vermiculite just because it's sterile, it works, it holds things up, and it's easy to have and easy to have on hand. So I use it for everything, all my cuttings.
Even woody cuttings?
Even woody cuttings, okay. And I'll root things right in there. You can use the potting media, just the potting soil, as long as it's good and clean and sterile. It's, again, that's really important that we keep things clean. We want to start out fresh so you have maximum success. Now, we don't have to just propagate our flowering plants. We've got foliage plants. A lot of you have hanging baskets. This is one of my favorites. This is a Hoya, or the wax plant. And, you know, again, we take small cuttings. Here you see, again, that 3 to 5 inch long cutting. We've got a little bit of stem that we can dip into our rooting hormone, tap off the excess, just as I showed you before. And here, I'm going to go ahead and plant into our soil media here, and just enough to hold it up. And we'll do the same thing with this cutting. And it's this simple to be able to create and expand our own cuttings and our own plant inventory. And very quickly, you can see how these will root very fast. Again, probably in about 6 weeks, those will be rooted and growing, and, you know, we'll have another nice full pot.
Now, I noticed when you cut your plants, you use special tools. Tell me a little bit about what you use between plants. How do you disinfest them? And what's your trick to that?
Well, you know, we want to start out, number one, with good quality pruning shears, something that's clean. And so it's a good idea to sterilize from time to time. Now, you can use alcohol. Isopropyl alcohol works fine. You can use
full strength?
It works fine, or you can use half strength.
Okay.
And you can also use 10% bleach solution. Okay. It can be a little corrosive. It'll rust your pruning shears if you don't oil up afterwards. So just kind of be cautious with that, but either one works fine, and those are products that are readily available.
Okay. It sounds like we've got a caller on the line. Hi, caller. I guess we do. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question today?
My question is that I have these things that my sister has called cats and kittens, and they're succulents. And she has them in a pot, and so I broke off two of them, and I just stuck them in the ground, and I don't know if they're really going to take hold or if you have to do that rooting medium thing.
Okay. What do you think, Tom?
Well, it leads us right into what we were going to talk about next was growing succulents. Succulents are pretty easy to propagate, and one nice thing to do with succulents, and here we have a jade plant, and, you know, it's a nice succulent plant. So when we talk about succulents, we're talking about plants that are holding moisture, and it sounds like that's what you have at your home. And so, you know, all you do, again, just make small cuttings, just like what we saw before, but with succulents, it's best if you leave these sit for about 2 days in a cool, dry place. And that will allow this end to callus off and harden. If we were to plant this right away, it has a better chance of possibly rotting, and we want to avoid that. But this will end will callus up, it'll harden up a little bit, and then it's time for us to plant. We'll plant it in the same media that we would do just like what we just showed you, either in the vermiculite or in good clean potting media, and we may take off a leaf or two just so it'll stand up, and we're ready to go.
What about if you just plant the leaf? Do you think one leaf by itself after it's been sitting out will propagate something?
With some plants, we can grow from leaf cuttings, others not.
Now, what about cactus? It's obviously a succulent. Does each cactus differ?
Yeah, with a lot of your plants, it's going to differ from one species to the next. So it's really important that you do a little bit of research, find out what you have, and find out what if there are any tricks and techniques for how you're going to grow that and how you're going to multiply.
Now, are you going to use vermiculite with that too, or would you use like a sterile sand, beach sand?
You know, sand is another element that would work very well. It's another media that would hold the plant up. It also provides a little bit of moisture. It's going to dry out a little bit faster. And for a succulent, that might work out really well. And if you look at succulent potting medias, they often have a large sand component so that it's a little more coarse, doesn't hold as much moisture. These are very easy to grow, and they'll root in most anything you do.
Well, we've got another caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question today?
Oh, I just wanted to ask, how would the plant get oxygen if it was in the clear bag?
Oh, that's a smart viewer. Okay, Tom.
That's a great question. And, you know, when it's in the bag, you know, it's realized that the plant is producing oxygen. It's going to be taking in CO2, and as it goes through the photosynthesis process, it'll produce oxygen. And that's why we want to open it up every couple of days to get some gas exchange, allow some fresh air in there. So we wouldn't want to leave it sealed up for good. What some people might do is they might seal it most of the way up, but not completely, and that way it'll allow for a little bit of gas exchange. But if you do seal it all the way up, just make sure you open it up after a couple of days. But that's a wonderful question.
Now, with photosynthesis, though, plants need CO2. So I've seen people breathe in their bags. Do you ever do that?
It's more work than I want to do.
I know.
I guess you could. If you increase that CO2 level a little bit, actually it may speed the process along, speed the photosynthesis along. But in this way, we're really just wanting to root. We're not looking to push growth or anything at this point in time. We're wanting it to root.
I see. All right. Oh, we've got another caller on the line. So before we get started on this one, we're going to welcome the caller to the show. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question?
Yes. This is Shirley. I'd like to know more about poinsettias. I have some that's still doing very well. And I'd like to know if I can still cut them back. I don't have any flowers, but I do have still the leaves.
Now, poinsettias are a wonderful crop, and they're a great crop for the landscape. And a lot of people don't realize that after the holidays, that when they have their poinsettias, once they've faded and aren't colorful anymore, they can cut their plants back, put them in a nice sunny location in the landscape, away from artificial light sources, and we can go ahead and plant those right in the landscape, and they work out well. probably the biggest thing is we'll prune them probably every 4 to 6 weeks from about April through the beginning of September, end of August, and then we don't want to prune them anymore because they'll set their flower buds as we move into October, typically in central or north Florida.
Now, how would you propagate a poinsettia?
Poinsettias root very nicely from cuttings.
Oh, good.
And so
spring, summer?
Almost any time during that warm season when we're pruning them back, we can root those cuttings and realize that, you know, the commercial growers, they're planting their rooted cuttings typically about August to get their holiday flower.
I see. Well, we've got another caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question today?
Karen, I want to propagate a crepe myrtle, and I'd like to know where I should take the cutting from.
That's a good question.
Crepe myrtles are really easy, and one of the old nursery tricks that we used to do years ago was to take the cuttings during the dormant season. So we might take an 8-inch cutting, maybe, of crepe myrtle, and we'll put it in potting media, and no mist, no nothing, and, you know, it'll root very easily during the dormant season. They can root from cuttings during the warmer season as well. The question is, where do we take that cutting? Normally, we're using from the upper portion of the plant, not including the flower buds or seed heads.
Now, sometimes I use suckers at the base. If it's not grafted or anything, I'll use the suckers, and that'll be juvenile growth, too, so I'll get some cuttings off that, too. As long as it's not soft and limpy, it's got to be able to snap.
Yeah, we'll call that semi-hardwood cuttings,
sure.
And that's the best. Don't take that freshest stuff, but the growth that started to harden off a little bit.
Right. We have another caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question?
By the way, your program is quite informative and thought-provoking. Is there any reason when you would not use hormone? Could you use the hormones on seedlings?
Typically, we don't need rooting hormones for seedlings because normally those hormones have auxins, which are creating roots. Our seedlings are going to put out roots naturally, so it's not necessary. We'll use complete fertilizers to fertilize once we get those seedlings up and growing. So excellent question, though. We really don't need to do it on seedlings, but we'll use a complete fertilizer, and that could be a liquid product, it could be a time-release product, lots of different choices out there.
And I have to tattletale on Tom, because when you use your rooting hormone, you're supposed to be wearing gloves, so
shh.
Shame on Tom. Everybody at home, make sure you use your gloves, because it could be a problem, but... go ahead, Tom. Now we're gonna take one more phone call, I think we have Carla. Carla from Christmas. Welcome to the program, Carla. What's your question?
Hello, my name is Paula.
Paula.
Yes. My name is Paula, and I live in Christmas. And we have a azalea plant that was beautiful blooming in the springtime, but with all the rain that we've had here in Christmas, it's drooping. And the leaves are falling off, and we're wanting to know, is there anything that we can do to save it?
Well, when we start thinking about azaleas that are dropping leaves and have a kind of limp growth to them, that sounds like there may be some sort of root issue, and it doesn't sound good. It's not normal for the plant to do that. So, you know, probably what you want to do is maybe take a cutting of that, take a sample into the extension office, have them take a look at it. If it's not a huge plant, if it's a nice small plant, you may want to dig it up, examine the roots, maybe even bring the whole plant into the extension office if it's not too much for you to do. And that way, you know, you can find out what's going on. But if you look at the roots, if they're not nice and white, if they're black and kind of mushy and soggy, you've got some root issues there.
And Paula, what you can do, if you have a cell phone of any type that has a camera on it, you can also photograph it and then email it in to me, and I'll see if I can figure out what it is, or take it to your local extension office and email it to them if that's easier for you, or have a friend do it for you. So
wonderful.
With today's technology, you know, if you're not mobile, or if you want to, you know, make it a little bit more easier through the email, try that. All right, Tom. Real quick, you're going to tell us how to propagate this beast here.
This is an old-timey plant. This is the Sansevieria, or sometimes called mother-in-law's tongue, also snake plant, a lot of different names for this one. They come in lots of different colors, lots of variegated patterns. This one's got a nice silvery look to it.
I love
the new growth on these. You see that this plant, and you know, you look at this container, it's busting out the sides almost. And so it's one of those things. One way we can propagate these is by dividing these. And that's another propagation technique. And so all we have to do is take this out of the container. Thank you very much, Karen.
Now, good. Tom, I want the silver variety. So do you separate, will I get silver on the others, or are you guaranteed the silver on this one? Will it outgrow it?
This is all the same. And what happens is the newer growth is silver. Eventually, it goes to green, like you see in the older tissue here. If you look on the other side here, we've also got some silver coming out the newer growth here. But wherever we divide this, what's going to happen is new growth is going to come out, so you're going to get the nice new silver. And you could divide this, we could divide this easily into probably 5, 6, 7 pieces. And, you know, sometimes you might take a knife, sometimes you might take pruning shears, and all you have to do is find a spot where it looks like it might be a good place to start splitting it out. And I'm going to make a nice mess here, and you can see we can pull it apart a little bit.
I hear snap, crackling, and popping.
And sometimes that's a good thing.
And while we're getting close to the end of the show, Tom, use your muscles and...
There we go. We've created a nice division there, and all we'd have to do is put this into our nice new pot. We will put some nice clean potting media around it.
That's our show for today, and I'd like to thank my guest Tom Wickman and thank all of you for joining in today's program. For more information, email me at wdsc@daytonastate.edu. Now go forth and multiply those plants. And see you next week on Gardener's Hotline.